A very good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting. Moving on to agenda item one, we have had a change in committee membership and I would like to welcome John Mason to the committee, who replaces James Dornan. I thank James for his valued contribution to the committee, and our first item of business today is to invite John Mason to declare any relevant interests.
Yeah, I do not think I have anything relevant to declare.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to agenda item two, our next item of business for today. Marie.
Thanks. Just to declare that I'm a previous councillor from 2003 to 2022.
Okay. I also have Paul Kane wanting to come in and Ros McCall.
Thank you, convener. I was previously a councillor from 2012 until 2022.
Thanks, Paul. Ros?
I was also a councillor from 2017 for that term.
Okay. And can I just declare an interest as well? I was also a local councillor for South Lanarkshire from 2017 to 2021. And I believe Jeremy wants to come in as well.
Thank you, Vina. I'll just join everybody else. I was a former councillor in Edinburgh City Council from 2015.
Okay. I don't see any other hands up, so moving on. So our next item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Moving on to agenda item 3. Our next item is the consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Amendment No. 3 Regulations 2023. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and the purpose of the instrument is to amend certain council tax regulations to make sure some payments are not regarded as capital or income when calculating entitlements to council tax reduction. The payments concerned are the Grenfell Tower payments, the post office compensation payments, and the vaccine damage payments. The instrument also clarifies that the capital of the person liable to pay council tax has no impact on the person's entitlement to second adult rebate, and that Irish citizens who come to Scotland from Ukraine do not require leave to enter or remain in the United Kingdom. Do members have any comments on the instrument? I invite the committee then to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So moving on to agenda item 4, kinship care. Next this morning is an evidence session on kinship care, and this follows on from the committee's short inquiry into kinship care in 2022. And I welcome to the meeting Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children's, Young People and Keeping the Promise. I also welcome HUD officials Dawn Abel, Unit Head Caregivers, and Louisa Brown, Family Care Team Leader, Improving Lives for People with Care Experience, Scottish Government. So I thank you for joining us today. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So, members online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. I'm very, very grateful to the committee for inviting me along this morning to give evidence, and I really welcome the opportunity to discuss the new Scottish recommended allowance for foster and kinship carers, and of course the wider work that the Scottish Government is undertaking to support kinship carers. Kinship care has evolved over many decades, and during that time there has come an increased recognition and value for the role that kinship carers play in providing secure, stable and loving homes for children and young people when they are no longer able to live with their birth parents. Now, I want to put on record my sincere thanks to kinship carers at the outset for stepping in to provide children with a home, often at very short notice and within complicated family dynamics. I know that given this care can be multifaceted, and that is why the Scottish Government is committed to providing both financial and practical support for kinship carers so they are best equipped to love and nurture the children that they look after. Now, on the 30th of March last year, we published our implementation plan, setting out the actions that we would take to keep the promise by 2030. And in the plan, we restated our intention to introduce a Scottish recommended allowance for kinship and foster carers in order to end the inequality and ensure consistency across Scotland. As the committee knows, this has been a Scottish Government commitment since 2018, and I know that the time it has taken to deliver on this has been a source of frustration to both caregivers and stakeholders. And that's why in August this year, I was really delighted to announce that we had reached agreement with COSLA about a new national weekly allowance that all local authorities must pay to their foster and kinship carers. We estimate that the new Scottish recommended allowance will benefit more than 9,000 children, and it's been funded by an additional £16 million from the Scottish Government. This funding enables the allowance to be backdated to the 1st of April this year. Now, it is of course up to local authorities to decide how best to do that and to make sure that there are no unintended consequences for families. We do know from some initial feedback that some local authorities have already implemented the new allowance and have made the back payments. Others are expecting to do so at the end of November or soon afterwards. And we will use our existing forums, groups and networks as feedback loops to help identify any obstacles to implementation, and importantly to help local authorities to overcome any obstacles and share good practice. Now, once the Scottish recommended allowance has bedded down, we will also review it more formally and identify any areas where improvements could be made. Now, when I announced the new allowance, I committed to maintain the 23-24 levels of support for the allowances going forward and to review the funding implications for future years from 24-25. Like all of you, I'm acutely aware of the cost of living pressures on families, and I am currently considering what we might do for future years given our fixed budget and the significant financial challenges we're facing. Now, I'll be able to say more on this after the Scottish budget has been set out by the Parliament in December. Now, we recently had Care Experience Week, which was an opportunity for everyone to celebrate the Care Experience community. I visited Siblings Reunited, or STAR, otherwise known as, and met staff and a small group of volunteer supporters. STAR provides a safe environment to bring together sibling groups separated in care to form positive experiences and relationships. And what this visit really reiterated to me was that while important, funding is only one part of how we can improve the experiences of those in care and for their carers too. And that's one of the reasons why, along with partners, we established the Kinship Care Collaborative in 2020. Now, as you'll know from your previous inquiry, it's working hard to deliver improvements in support for kinship carers, children and professionals working with kinship families across Scotland. Following recommendations in last year's Social Justice and Social Security Committee report on kinship care, the Collaborative established a rewrite group to refresh the existing kinship care guidance for practitioners. The rewrite group have been examining the guidance with a view to updating it so that it reflects updated legislation and also growing knowledge and experience of what works in kinship care. The refreshed guide will also clarify many of the issues that both the committee and stakeholders have told us that are open to interpretation. This includes the meaning of at risk of being looked after and placed with the involvement of the local authority. And our aim is to publish this by the end of the year. Alongside this, a group of practitioners are helping us to develop a new national kinship assessment framework, which will complement the refreshed guidance and will help to improve the consistency of approach and practice. We're also taking action to promote the work of the collaborative, as I know this is an issue the committee raised previously, and ensure that it is open, transparent and accessible to all stakeholders, kinship care families and others with care experience. More broadly, work is also ongoing across wider government to support kinship carers. For example, we're working with partners and caregivers to develop a plan for delivering trauma training for kinship and foster carers, as well as adoptive parents. We've also made it easier for kinship carers to apply for Scottish Social Security benefits that they are eligible for, expanding the definition of kinship carer to make it as inclusive as possible in consultation with those with lived experience. I believe that the totality of the work happening across government, specifically to target kinship carers, but also help families more generally, should help us to achieve our ambition to keep the promise by 2030. Finally, I just want to say that I really welcome the committee's interest in kinship care and the Scottish recommended allowance, and I'm equally happy to answer any questions that you may have for me this morning. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. We'll now move on to questions, and our questions will be directed to you, but you are, of course, welcome to invite any of your officials to respond, should you wish to do so. So I'm going to kick off with question number one, and how work towards providing clear and accessible information for kinship carers about legal arrangements around kinship care and how to access their rights, support and advice. How is that progressing?
So this is obviously extremely important, and I touched on this in my opening statement. Yeah. We need to ensure that kinship carers can access their rights, the support and advice that they are entitled to. So the Kinship Care Collaborative established a communications subgroup. It gave a clear steer that the first step towards this was to ensure that local authority websites held up-to-date information on their kinship care policies. Now, the subgroup has written to the Office of the Chief Social Worker requesting its assistance in contacting all of our local authority chief social work officers to highlight the importance of ensuring that that relevant information is published and that it's updated regularly and made available to carers and practitioners. And this is a legal requirement under the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland Order 2016. Now, the letter to the Office of the Chief Social Worker also asks that local authority websites provide links to the Kinship Care Advisory Service for Scotland website, which is funded by the Scottish Government. And this website contains a wide range of information that will assist kinship carers, such as financial support like welfare benefits, information on legal orders. And the advice service also runs a helpline that offers a callback service when out of normal operating hours, and it provides a range of free training packages. So there is work going on there. As I said at the beginning, we understand that it's extremely important, and I'm positive that this ongoing work will help to improve matters.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to pass over to Paul O'Kane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and her officials. I suppose just building on that, so there is obviously information and advice available, as you've outlined. I think I'm keen to understand how are people aware of that, you know, particularly for those kinship carers who are entering into that kinship arrangement for the very first time and perhaps are navigating a new landscape. So what kind of action has the government and its agencies taken to make sure that information is getting out to people?
Sure. So I would say, although it is the responsibility of the local authorities to ensure that that information is available, as I said at the beginning, we appreciate the importance of this and want to ensure that people have the information and support that they need. So I think the launch of the refreshed guidance will provide a really good opportunity for everyone in the care sector to promote kinship care as an option for children and young people. And we will ensure that information on the Scottish Government website alongside that, as well as the Kinship Care Advisory Service, is updated regularly. So I think there's a lot of work ongoing with that. As I said, it is down to the local authorities, but the Scottish Government are providing support to ensure that that information is available and accessible. And we'll continue to monitor that and look at ways that we could possibly improve that as well.
OK, Okay, thank you. I wonder if the Minister can also update on the guidance rewrite group and how updated guidance will be communicated with local authorities. So, you know, we're talking about local authorities having the key role, essentially, in disseminating this information. But how do we ensure that there's kind of a smooth implementation at that point for local authorities?
Sure. So I appreciate there's obviously been a slight delay in the publication of that guidance, and that was really because we wanted to ensure that we engaged really widely. But I believe I mentioned in my opening remarks, we are on schedule to publish that by the end of the year. And the rewrite group is currently refining the document, and it will be reviewed by members of the reference group once they are content with that. And this includes the Child Poverty Action Group, the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, and the Kinship Care Advisory Service for Scotland. And we're also intending to engage with kinship carers in the last week in November, so that will be included in that as well. I think it's really worth highlighting that the Collaborative also agreed to form a working group that would develop a new national assessment framework for kinship care. And that framework reflects that the kinship assessment is unique in that it assesses a carer for the needs of a specific child, unlike a foster care assessment, and also considers what extra support might be required within the family. Now, the framework has been developed as a companion piece to the refreshed guidance, and so it's going to be published at the same time as that. And there are plans to put in place a programme of awareness raising and training for practitioners and managers and local authorities to support the rollout and the implementation of this guidance and the assessment framework. And this is all with the aim of improving practice in Scotland.
Can I just very briefly, Convener, I just wonder to what extent has the social work profession been engaged in all of this work, either through Social Work Scotland or the representative bodies?
So there has been engagement with social work. I'll bring officials in to give a little bit more clarity around that.
So the Kinship Care Collaborative is co-chaired by myself and Ben Faradja from Social Work Scotland. So they've been involved from the very beginning. The rewrite groups and the other subgroups that operate as part of the collaborative have members of local authorities on them. And indeed, the assessment framework group has got service managers who are advising on what an assessment framework for kinship care would look like. So fully involved from start to finish.
And I wonder to what extent have they raised concerns about capacity in local authorities and resource in order to be able to deliver an updated and refreshed framework and to actually, you know, on the front line implement the changes that we're talking about?
Louisa, you may wish to come in on this. My understanding from working with social work across the piece on a range of issues is there is a capacity issue, generally, as you're aware. They've not expressed any significant concerns about being able to implement the updated guidance or indeed the assessment framework. In terms of the assessment framework, at the moment, there isn't a national tool, so lots of different local authorities are using different forms. And what they've told us is that they would actually welcome something from the government that they could use that would actually help them improve practice and would actually improve consistency. Rather than them scraping about for bits and bobs and adapting existing frameworks that they have in place at the moment.
That's fair.
Very helpful. Thank you, Kevin.
Thanks very much. Moving on to Marie McNair now. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. I'm aware of the work on kinship care being carried out in both health and social care partnerships within my constituency, and I know they've started to issue back payments, so I'm interested as to when local authorities will receive the £16 million announced by the Scottish Government. And, Minister, are you confident the money will be sufficient?
Yes, absolutely. I'm absolutely confident that there is sufficient funding there to support the rollout of the recommended allowance. The £16 million figure, that funding, it was based on the difference between the cost of paying the Scottish recommended allowance or higher and the current local authority expenditure on foster and kinship care allowances. And that has been negotiated. That's been worked out through negotiations with COSLA. It's been modelled using current local authority expenditure on children in foster and kinship care, including informal kinship care, and the most up-to-date data from the Children's Social Work Statistics. Now, on the 18th, just in relation to when they'll receive that funding, on the 18th of October, the Scottish Government issued a letter to local authority directors of finance detailing how much funding they were receiving, and this letter would enable local authorities to implement the allowance knowing the level of funding that they'll receive. The actual money itself will be transferred from the Scottish Government at the end of the financial year through the Local Government Settlement Funding Mechanism, and as you'll be aware, this is standard practice. Regarding distribution, the £16 million funding is being distributed on the same basis as the existing kinship care allocation. So this distribution has recently been changed to, and I've got the figures here, 35% numbers of children aged 0 to 18 in low-income families, 35% numbers of children in receipt of Scottish Child Payments, and 30% in the 0 to 18 general population, and that's for the full 23 to 24 financial year.
Thanks for that information, Minister. Can you advise what information you have with regards to how many local authorities are delivering the minimum rate so far?
I touched on this a little bit in my opening statement. The Scottish Government doesn't actually hold information on what local authorities have already backdated the payments, because it's up to local authorities to decide how best to implement that according to their systems. And I'm aware for some local authorities, implementing the allowance might require either changes to their financial systems, as well as calculating those backdated amounts and contacting carers. So the time needed to undertake this might be different for each local authority. However, we have received positive feedback that some local authorities have already implemented the new allowance and have made those back payments. Others are expecting to do so by the end of November and soon afterwards. Now, I just want to be really clear, this is a legal requirement as set out in the Kinship Care Assistance Order, which requires local authorities to publish information about kinship care assistance, and that includes the rate at which allowances are payable. And as part of that grant letter that went out in October, the Scottish Government has also asked local authorities to publish its kinship and fostering allowances and to take the necessary actions to ensure that all current kinship and foster carers are aware of the rates. So, as I say, we're positive, absolutely positive, that this will be carried out in a good time based on how that local authority needs to carry that out, and we'll be monitored going forward as well.
Thanks, Minister. No further questions.
I'm going to bring Jeremy in, who's on online with us, for a quick supplementary, and then I'm going to invite Ros McCollan. Thanks.
Good morning, Minister, and to your civil servants. Just to follow up the very last point that you made, clearly, as a committee, we're keen to see that this does happen across all 32 local authorities. My understanding is that COSLA don't keep this information either. I'm wondering, is it your intention to write out to local authorities at the end of this financial year to make sure that they have done this? And if you do that, would it be possible to share that information with the committee towards the middle of this year?
Absolutely. I would obviously hope that it wouldn't get to that stage. And as I say, we've already had really positive feedback in terms of the local authorities who have implemented this already. I hope by the end of the financial year we'll have that positive feedback that this has been implemented across the board. But yes, absolutely. And happy to share information, back with the committee if required.
Thank you, Minister.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCollan. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Thank you very much indeed for your opening statement. That was very informative. I'm looking for some clarity this morning. Stakeholder groups have called for the Scottish Government to clarify which kinship carers are eligible for the Scottish recommended allowance. So can you give me clarity on that, please?
Absolutely, and I appreciate that is required. to be very, very clear, there has been no change in legislation to this, with this. So the eligibility of kinship carers for the allowance remains the same as outlined by the kinship care guidance for practitioners. So essentially, kinship carers who hold a kinship care order and receive an allowance under the Kinship Care Assistance Scotland order remain eligible for the allowance. We are, however, as I've mentioned, refreshing the guidance on kinship care to make that clearer. And as I mentioned earlier, my expectation is that that will be published by the end of the year, because I know that, stakeholders and carers are calling out for that. Kinship carers, just on the eligibility, kinship carers who are looking after children under Section 7 or Section 25 of the Children Scotland Act, or Section 83 of the Children Scotland Act 2011 would also be eligible for the allowance. But as I say, I know that's a bit of a muddled landscape, so I'm hoping that the refreshed guidance adds a little bit of clarity around that.
Thank you. That would be that'd be very good to read. I don't think there's really anyone that can't identify the difference between the needs of a 5-year-old and a 15-year-old. However, the allowance for 5 to 11 and 11 to 15 is exactly the same. So Kinship Care Advice Service of Scotland has said that that's challenging to understand. Can you give your reasonings behind that, please?
Absolutely. And I've heard some of the commentary around this too. So in terms of those allowances, the group who undertook the 2018 National Review of Care Allowances, which was informed by consultation with stakeholders, with caregivers and with children and young people, decided that the allowance payment rate should be broken down into three age groups. So that was the 0 to 4, the 5 to 15 and the 16 plus. These age bands are also comparable to those used in Wales for the allowance in Wales. I think it's fair to say that the evidence is limited and rather mixed. Some people tend to think that babies and young children, toddlers, are more costly, whilst others think that older children are more costly to look after. Now, the most recent research that we've seen conducted by Money Farm suggests that in 2023 it's more costly to support a 6 to 11-year-old than to support a 12 to 14-year-old, and they attribute this to the cost of age-appropriate toys for younger children and the rate at which clothes and school uniforms, things like that, need to be replaced. What I would say is the allowance has only just been introduced. It's obviously a hugely positive move. However, we are open to the feedback. We'll continue to gather that feedback from kinship carers and stakeholders, and we will consider this issue when we formally review its implementation in the future, as I've previously mentioned.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. No, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Katie Clark. Thank you.
Thank you. And I was going to ask about how uplifts will be calculated to take into account the cost of living increase. Will that be by inflation or another formula?
So, yes, absolutely. Very switched on to the cost of living pressures, and work is ongoing to consider the funding implications for future years for 24-25, as I'm sure you're all aware, in the context of inflation, in the context of our fixed budget, and the significant financial challenges that the Scottish Government are currently facing. I think I'd probably be able to say more on this after the Scottish Budget and has been set out in December. Discussions with COSLA around uprating will be picked up in due course. But as I said in my opening statement, the Scottish Government did make a commitment to maintaining the 23-24 levels of support and to reviewing those funding implications going forward. As I say, probably be able to say more after the budget process.
That's fine, and obviously if the Minister could keep the committee updated, that would be very helpful.
Of course.
And I mean, have you given thought to what more can be done for kinship carers who are not going to be eligible for this support?
Absolutely. And again, I think I mentioned that in my opening statement. It's although financial support is extremely valuable and required, there are other forms of support that kinship carers might need as well. Support, I think, can be practical and emotional as well as financial. So for example, a kinship carer could seek advice and support from their local authority at any point. But in terms of other support, the Scottish Government does provide funding to Adoption UK Scotland and the Association of Fostering Kinship and Adoption for the Kinship Advice Service for Scotland, and that's with the aim of delivering a wide range of support, advice and information to help kinship care families. We've also awarded £989,000 of whole family wellbeing funding to Adoption UK Scotland over the last 3 years to pilot a new approach to ensure that kinship carer families can get the range of holistic support that they need. And this has a focus on education and community support, including peer support.
Thank you. And are you able to give us an update regarding the recommendations of the English Independent Review of Children's Social Care and whether progress can be made towards the introduction of paid leave for new kinship carers?
So, absolutely. My officials are in regular contact with their counterparts in the UK government, and as I understand, whilst paid leave has been introduced by some organisations such as Tesco, I believe it's still being considered by the UK government. But I am very, very happy to write to my counterpart, the Secretary of State for Education, to request an update on this to see where we are.
That would be great, and obviously if you could share that with the committee, that would be very helpful.
Of course.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. As well as financial support, kinship carers may need other support and may also be nervous. We've had some evidence, I think, at committee that some kinship carers might be nervous if they go to local authority that there's going to be barriers raised and they might not be able to keep the children. And an obvious one would be housing, that, you know, an elderly couple might not have a large house and suddenly they've got the grandchildren with them. So can you say anything about that and how we're dealing with that?
Of course. I mean, so in terms of our overall values and our aims for this, good practice and the promise tells us that the best place for a child to live whenever a child is not able to live with their birth parents, it would be within the wider family. It's absolutely in the safe and best interests of the child to do so. And I don't think any kinship carer should ever feel isolated and unable to approach their local authority for support should they require it. I've already touched on some of the, if they did feel this way, I've already touched on some of the other kind of forms of support that they could access. But in terms of those specific concerns around not being able to keep that child, the consideration to remove a child from their kinship family would only be done after a full assessment of that situation. And it would not be taken lightly. Any decision to do that would not be taken lightly. It would only be done if there was evidence to suggest that it would be detrimental to the well-being of the child or young person to stay with that family. So I think efforts would be made to try and ensure that family could stay together. But again, I think the rollout of the guidance and the assessment framework that I've already alluded to will provide a further opportunity to underline the support that might be required for kinship families to access who might be having those thoughts or feeling that way.
Okay, so to press you a little bit further, is it possible that a council takes the children away because the grandparents would be overcrowded? They don't have enough bedrooms.
Well, based on what I said, I don't believe so, because that wouldn't be in line with the decision to ensure that the removal of the child was what's best for the child if it's simply down to a housing situation. Now, obviously, it's for the local authority to deal with their housing stock and everything, but I would imagine that best efforts would be made to ensure that family could stay together. I don't think that would be an acceptable reason for a child to be removed.
But Glasgow City Council doesn't have any housing stock.
Well, as I say, it would be down to the local authority, but I'm sure that efforts would be made to ensure that children could stay with their family. Down to the local authority.
Yeah, I mean, I accept a lot of it is down to the local authority, and hopefully a reasonable approach would be taken. But, I mean, sometimes we do find with some local authority officials that it's very much a legalistic approach that's taken. And if a house is technically overcrowded, then they just there's no movement on that. Yeah. And, you know, I hope that your words today are reassuring and will encourage people, but I think there is still a genuine fear. Just to kind of broaden it out a bit more, what other support, like schooling and things is important too, and children not moving school preferably, but obviously kinship carers might be further away. Can you say anything around these areas?
Absolutely. As I say, best efforts would be made to ensure that what is right for the child is kept as that, so that the child kind of faces as little as little disruption as possible. But I'll perhaps bring officials in to elaborate on that a little further for you.
Thank you, Minister. So I just wanted to mention a little bit more about the assessment framework and then to say something about how we're supporting children in schools. So the assessment framework that I mentioned earlier would look at the appropriateness of carers, but also what support is needed for the whole family, and so that the child could stay with that kinship carer. And some of that might involve education, housing and so on. In terms of education, the Scottish Government did introduce a Care Experience Children and Young People funding in 2018-19, which is part of the wider Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. And what that does is that provides funding to local authorities so that they can put in place initiatives to support Care Experience Children get the best educational outcomes that they can. And that would include those in kinship care. And there's also additional monies that were given for CELSIS, who you'll be aware of, to facilitate a network of virtual head teachers, again, to swap good practice and support around care experience children, young people.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I had a case some time ago, but the grandparents did live, some distance away from the parents, and they wanted the kids to go to the local school of the grandparents because that was going to make it a lot easier, but that local school was full. So is it entirely up to local authorities in that situation just how they prioritise places for the kids, or does the government have any thoughts on how that can be addressed?
I don't have any further detail on that. As I mentioned earlier, the assessment framework sets out the type of things that local authorities will want to consider when thinking about how they can best support kinship care families and their children.
I think just to add to that, obviously, in terms of our journey towards keeping the promise and everything that the Scottish Government is working on, aims and priorities, these kind of things are very useful to learn and to understand and to assess how we can help to ensure that situations like that don't happen, or, as I said in my previous answer, that disruption to the child is kept at a minimal level. So these are kind of ongoing processes, and we will consider them going forward.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to invite Ros in for a supplementary, and then I'll bring in Bob. Thanks.
Thank you. That was very interesting. And I would like to add a question on the blending between informal and formal. Everything we're talking about really obviously is formal kinship care, because that's through that process. But the support needs of people who might be nervous about coming forward for additional support because they have an informal arrangement and wouldn't want to see themselves moving into what would be considered a very formal arrangement. So is there any blending there, or how do you envisage that crossover line that always comes when you come to the outsides of any policy?
Sure. Again, I wouldn't want any kinship carer to feel like they are stuck in a situation and can't come forward to help seek the advice, the guidance or the support that they require. I'll again perhaps hand over to officials to go into a little bit more detail on that.
It shouldn't really matter whether you're formally looked after or in some sort of informal kinship care. The family should be able to approach their local authority and seek help and get an assessment of need and support without going through a formal route of the child becoming looked after. And they should get all the support that those children receive that are looked after. And like the Minister said, they shouldn't
feel reticent about doing that. It shouldn't feel like they're formalising it. They should just getting it right for any child. Any child should be able to, and family should be able to approach the local authority for the support that they need. And that is the intention with this. And we hope that the guidance also clarifies that further for families and practitioners, knowing that the support that's available.
Okay, so just to follow up on that, the guidance will therefore do that, but these are families that obviously aren't, so there needs to be a little bit of promotion in effect, or an understanding from people who are not currently through that social work process and that council process, that assistance is there, and will that be coming forward too?
I would like to say that when we launch the guidance, yes, we'd like to get that further out there, definitely through our virtual head teacher networks and education and other places. We'd really like to highlight kinship and the support that's available to all families. Yes.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
Thanks. I'll quickly come in with a question on that just before I bring in Bob. It's more related to the informal setting and kinship care, particularly for children and families who are on a temporary thing. Maybe it's because the parent or the carer is, going through the criminal justice system, or they're going through addiction services as well. Is that how much awareness is going out on that, and also the financial support there as well from an informal setting?
I think that certainly kinship awareness is being raised more generally, I think, in line with the promise and as we deliver on that. But perhaps there's more to be done in specific settings like justice and that. But children that are even in a wholly private arrangement in kinship, we still recognise them as kinship placements, and they should, be able to dip into the support if they need it and when they need it. Just because you a family stepped in to support and look after children and it's totally private and doesn't have any involvement, doesn't mean that circumstances can change and they don't need that support. And I'd certainly welcome people to come forward if they need that. But perhaps there is more, as we launch the guidance, to get that message out there to all settings where families might come into contact and raise the awareness of kinship. So certainly we can look at that further.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener. My convener, at the start, I couldn't get involved in an evidence session with kinship care without putting on record. I think my thanks, obviously, to campaigners, I first met in 2006, ahead of the 2007 elections and national hustings, and the constituents that I now serve in relation to that, but also the incoming Children's Minister, Adam Ingram, back in the day, and his work, challenging work in relation to kinship care payments, and indeed Glasgow City Council, who I met with back in those early days, who at that point agreed after meeting with me a £50 a week kinship care allowance. That seems tiny now, but at the time it was seen as real groundbreaking stuff. So how far we've come, but we obviously need to go further. So sorry, convener, for putting that on the record. Sometimes a kind of institutional memory is quite important in sessions like this. I actually had a supplementary in Mr Mason's point, which I'll ask before my substantive question, who was looking at the wider support that kinship carers receive. The wider support they often want is for the young people they're looking after, of course, a lot of them with emotional and mental health and wellbeing issues, have experienced significant trauma, and the weights that there are within sometimes CAMHS and other services, often delivered by the NHS rather than local authorities, understand as well. In my constituency, at the Notre Dame Centre, who's a real centre of excellence for dealing with that, and they take very specific referrals on kinship care. They have a very delicate funding framework to make sure they can continue to do that. So my substantive question, following up from Mr Mason, is to what extent, Minister, do you assure yourself that that wider support in terms of the emotional wellbeing of young people in kinship care and the trauma they've experienced is addressed adequately and consistently across Scotland?
I think it's a work in progress. I believe that this spans much further than what we are discussing in this room today. And we are continuing to listen to the voices of those with care experience to see what they require. In terms of CAMHS and things like that, we are seeing improvements and we are putting a lot of work into improving that for young people. And you mentioned trauma, and obviously I appreciate you were talking about the support for young people, but the support needs to be there for the carers as well to be able to deal with that in an appropriate manner. So that we are working, as I said in my previous answer to Ms McCall, I think we are working to develop a plan to provide trauma training for kinship, foster and adoptive parents. So I am positive about the work that is going on to support care experienced young people, but as I've said, I believe there's still more to do, and that will be continued to be led by the voices of those with care experience.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I'm sure the North Sam Centre would love to see you if your visit diary ever permitted to go along. I would love to take you and show you what excellent work they do. But I'll move on to my substantive question, which was going to be kind of more general about the progress that the Collaborative has made in recent months. But I've actually got a very specific question in relation to the progress that I think does need to be made. Now, I'd written down there's a guidance rewrite group and there's a national kinship assessment framework being developed to get that national consistency. I understand, I don't have an active case at the moment, but over the years, one of the issues with consistency is kinship and bereavement. I would explain it as where there's a gran or an auntie at hospital and a loved one passes away and the kids are there. Very vulnerable circumstances. Quite often what happens is gran steps in and says, I'll take those kids home. Now, if gran doesn't do that, social work services will say to gran, would you please look after these young people? They're very vulnerable. The outcome's the same. That was always going to happen. But one would be deemed to be an informal, volunteer-led relationship with the children and the local authority. And the other one would be the local authority placing the child with the kinship relative. Some local authorities, I understand, show really good flexibility in acknowledging that formal placement would have happened anyway. Others don't. It's inconsistent. This is a matter that's been raised with me over many years. So in relation to the work of the Collaborative and the Guidance Rewrite Group and the National Kinship Assessment Framework, and indeed that access to the Scottish Recommended Allowance, can you give me an assurances, Minister, that those types of situations have been taken into account and guidance and best practice will be rolled out, putting the onus on local authorities to do the right thing by kinship carers and bereavement?
Absolutely. I would already expect local authorities to do the right thing in terms of what Mr Doris is referring to. But as I've said, I expect that the refreshed guidance and that work that is ongoing will make that much clearer for local authorities, and we're hoping for that to be published by the end of the year. So absolutely, I'm very understanding and switched on. I've dealt with my own cases around this, and as I said, that is something that we're trying to improve, provide more clarity for local authorities.
So, Minister, would we get to see like a case study within that guidance? Because guidance can be a kind of dry and dusty thing, but I think what social work professionals would like to see would be, you know, a case study where the situation I've outlined to you, perhaps more eloquently than I have, Minister, but that I've outlined to you is it shows them what they should be doing rather than, yes, maybe sometimes what they are doing. Because when there's finances underpinning this and a budgetary impact on the local authority, we have to make sure there's best practice and not budgetary practice, if I can put it delicately like that.
Absolutely. And to take the decision based on budgetary practice would be going against everything that we're aiming for in terms of the promise. So, yes, absolutely, in answer to your question.
Really helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to finally bring in Jeremy Balfour, who's joining us again online. Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning again, Minister. I wonder if you could just, as we look forward now, what are the next steps for the Collaborative?
So, as you know, well, first of all, I would just really like to say I would give a thanks to the members of the Collaborative for their very hard work and their commitment to delivering change in this regard. As members will be aware, the Collaborative was formed in late 2020 and many people volunteered to give up what has been a considerable amount of their time to attend meetings. Through this time, participants have shared expertise and understanding of the issues in kinship care, many of which we have discussed this morning, and that's helped to inform and drive the work of the Collaborative going forward. So publishing the refreshed guidance and that new assessment framework that we've been discussing this morning will be really, really key milestones. And I think for me, we should perhaps then sit back for a second to take stock in collaboration with the Collaborative, quite a tongue twister there, about what the future might look like. And I'm very, very happy to keep the committee informed of any decisions on that going forward.
Thank you, Minister. Some stakeholders have suggested that the Kinship Care Collaborative could have a role in gathering information about the rollout of the Scottish recommended allowance, as we discussed previously. What consideration had the Minister given to this? And as they reflect, is this still a role that I think they could play going forward?
Yeah, absolutely. I absolutely agree that the Kinship Care Collaborative, alongside others, some stakeholders that we've already touched on this morning, the Kinship Carers Advisory Group, the Fostering Network, Social Work Scotland, could all have a key role to play in feeding back about the allowance. And I think, as I've already mentioned, their engagement to date has been extremely valuable and has really helped to inform the development of the recommended allowance, the recommended allowance information page that was published on the Scottish Government website this week. Now, the next meeting of the Collaborative is on the 27th of November, and I've asked officials to discuss with members how they might inform work on the allowance going forward and how this might feed into the next steps for the Collaborative. So, absolutely, I think that is going to be very vital. As I've already said, we're committed to formally reviewing that, and I think taking some of these organisations, stakeholders with us will be vital.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you, Kamina.
Okay, thanks very much, and thank you, Minister, and thank you to your officials as well. I found it very informative, and about the heart of it is about our children and young people and the carers as well, and my heart goes out to all the kinship carers as well here in Scotland. So I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a panel change before we move on to the next item of business, but thank you once again.
Okay, so welcome back, and our next agenda item is the first evidence session on the Scottish Employment Injuries Assistance Advisory Council Bill, SEAC Bill for short. This is a member's bill introduced by Mark Griffin MSP on the 8th of June 2023. It is currently at stage one. So the bill seeks to establish a new body, the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council, or SEAC, to provide expertise about support for people who can no longer work because of workplace injury or disease. So SEAC would have three functions: to report on draft regulations for employment injuries assistance, replacing the Scottish Commission on Social Security's role in this, to report to the Parliament and Ministers on any matter relevant to employment injuries assistance, and to carry out commission or support research into any matter relevant to employment injuries assistance. So I welcome our panel for this first evidence session on the bill and who are joining us remotely. We've got Dr. Leslie Rushton, Chair of Industrial Injuries Advisory Council, and Dr. Mark Simpson, Interim Co-Chair for Scottish Commission on Social Security. So can I thank you all for accepting our invitation. And just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. If you could wait until myself or a member asking the question say your name before speaking. Don't feel you have to answer every single question either. And if you've nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's okay as well. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. And you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So I am now going to invite members to ask questions in turn. And can I just remind everybody for this particular panel, it is purely on the context setting of that bill. So I'm now going to bring in our first... John Mason, invite John to ask the first few questions. Thank you, John.
Okay, thanks, Convener. And I am completely new to this committee, so this is a completely new subject to me, and so maybe some of my questions will be a little bit simplistic, but we'll, hopefully that will help others as well who are less familiar with the subject. So, as I understand it, we currently have several bodies. We have the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council, we have the Scottish Commission on Social Security, and we have the Disability and Carer Benefits Expert Advisory Group. And we're now talking about also having the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council. So maybe if I can start with you, Dr. Rushton, can you just give me a brief summary of how these all relate to each other and how it would change if we had this new body?
Well, I can tell you... Can you hear me all right?
Yes, that's great.
I can tell you about IAC. We don't have, as my understanding, any direct discussions with some of the other bodies that you have mentioned. If I just briefly tell you what we do.
Yes.
We are responsible for giving advice to ministers on industrial injuries disablement benefit, which, as you know, is part of our social security system. There's been some kind of worker compensation through this since, well, the 1920s, but more officially since the 1940s after the war. The committee, IAC, has been going since it's an Act of Parliament in 1946, but it's been going since 1948. So we've been doing this a long time. So what we do is we review and collate and write various reports on different issues concerning IIDB. Most of our work concerns diseases and occupations, but of course, there's a very important accident provision as well under IIDB. We look at all sorts of different occupational related ill health. Ranges over everything, from musculoskeletal to infectious diseases, viruses, and so on. We get our work, if you like, from constantly monitoring the literature as to what's coming up. So we might, for example, look at the International Agency of Research on Cancers reports and so on. We get a lot of requests from individuals, through constituents, from MPs, or MPs directly. We might get requests from parliamentary groups, such as the Environmental Audit Committee, for example. So that's what we do, and we write various different types of reports. We have information notes, which is a quick, when we've had a quick look at something. We have a position paper, which is where we're a very detailed review of a piece of disease and occupational data, but we haven't made recommendations. And then there's a command paper where we do, it's the same, we do a detailed review of the evidence, and there is, we do make recommendations to ministers. Both the last two papers are published, everything is published on our website, including all our detailed minutes of every single meeting. We have 8 meetings a year, 4 for the main council, and then we have a more of a research working group, which meets in between those 4 times. And what happens after we make recommendations is that if the minister is willing and approves, the command papers are what's called laid before Parliament, because it has a potentially direct impact on the legislation, which I think goes back to about built into the 1992 Social Security Act. When that has been published, then the DWP do a lot of work in order to prevent, to give information to the ministers on the impact that this particular recommendation would have. So it'd be a financial impact, numbers of people it would affect, and so on. And that's all done behind it within the DWP. The IAC doesn't have direct influence on that at all. We're not a lobby group, but at our meetings, we do have a lot of observers, both from policy, from the decision makers group in Barnsley, from medical assessors. We have people from Northern Ireland. We have an observer from HSE. And the committee is made up of about 11, it varies, but we're in the middle of starting another recruitment, between 10 and 12 independent experts who are scientists of various kinds, respiratory people, musculoskeletal, epidemiologists like myself. I'm a statistician, epidemiologist. And we also have equal representation from members who represent employer organisations and members who represent unions and worker organisations. So that's a bit of a long answer, but it sums up exactly what we do, I hope. Please do ask any more questions.
OK, well, I think probably my colleagues will have more questions, but that was helpful and certainly helped me understand a bit better what was going on. So if I can turn to you, Dr. Simpson, I mean, it just seems a very complicated landscape, and yet we've just heard how one of the bodies has a very, pretty wide remit anyway. So I suppose my question is, are we needing all of these bodies? Is it clear what all of their remits are? And obviously you can speak for your own.
Sure. Well, it's a complicated landscape, as you say, but it's partly a complicated landscape because of the nature of social security devolution. So just I'll come on to the role of SCOS within that in a minute, but just to give a wee bit of context, that's at least part of the reason why SCOS exists in the first place, and I presume part of the reason why Mark Griffin sees a need for this this additional body, is that as part of the process by which parts of Social Security were devolved to the Scottish Parliament following the Smith Commission, the UK government took the decision that the Social Security Advisory Committee and the Industrial Injuries Advisory Council would not be authorised to advise the Scottish Government or Parliament on devolved benefits. So the SCOS was created with a view to filling the gap in terms of the scrutiny functions that certainly the SAC has provided at UK level. What that means in practice for our role, as some members will be aware, we have three, or depending on how you look at it, four central functions. The one that we spend most of our time on is pre-legislative scrutiny. So the Social Security Act will requires the Scottish Government to refer most sort of major sets of Social Security regulations to us for scrutiny before they're laid before the Parliament. We report on them, we make recommendations. In the region of 80 to 90% of those recommendations are accepted by the government up to this point. Some of those have resulted in changes to the regulations before they're laid. Others are more about things like administrative practice, guidance, communication, or things to consider in future reviews. The other things we do are to report on essentially any matter connected with Social Security that either the Parliament or the Scottish Government asks us to. And then the final piece in the jigsaw is our role monitoring the devolved system as a whole for compliance with the commitments in the Social Security Charter. I suppose if there's a major difference between our role and the envisaged role for the new body, it's that the majority of our functions are very much reactive. You know, we report on legislation or on regulations when they're referred to us. We write a report on something connected with Social Security when we're asked to by the Parliament or the government. The only sort of proactive part of our role is we get to decide to some extent what aspects of the Charter we want to look at, although even there's a reactive element because we're required to do a report if there's evidence brought to our attention of systemic non-compliance with a part of the Charter. So our role is largely reactive. The role envisaged for the new body in the draft bill has got more proactive elements to us, to our role. You asked as well about DACBIG, which is a body that's had a different role within the system and has now completed that role. And that was a much more forward-looking role of making policy recommendations for the developing devolved system. So its role was quite different to ours. I think I'm right in saying reasonably different to the role of the SAC at UK level as well. So hope that's a useful overview.
Yes, thank you. That is useful. So I'm learning as we go along. I mean, you, in one sense, you said, well, you're reactive, but on the other hand, you have you could look at almost anything that you were asked to. I mean, what would have to happen for your role to be changed? Would that be legislation at Scottish level, or would it need legislation at Westminster level, or does it not need legislation?
Yeah, well, this is something that could be in the pipeline to some extent, because there's just been a review of SCOS carried out, which could potentially result in a few changes to our functions, depending on what the government and parliament decide. But those those main functions that I've described are set out in the Social Security Act. So any changes to those would need to be in primary legislation through the Scottish Parliament. It's, you know, the UK government doesn't play a role in determining what we do.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCollan. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. My questions are both for Dr. Rushton. Thank you very much indeed for the overview that you've given. I am also reasonably new, not totally new, but reasonably new, and this is the first time I'm getting an understanding of what it is both bodies really actually do as far as this is concerned. So having said that, I'm aware that IAC can commission literature reviews. So can you very roughly give me an idea of what does IAC spend on these? Yeah, we'll start with that.
Okay, thank you for your question. I should just say, traditionally, all the work of reading all the reviews, all the papers, putting everything together, writing the reports, has been done for years, decades, by the members themselves. I've been chair since 2018, and one of the things I've been going on about is we need funding for research, and I was interested to see what figure had been put on for your proposed committee. To answer your direct question, we have one commissioned review at the moment, which is on selected respiratory diseases and both non-malignant and cancer. So we're particularly looking at lung cancers and silica, for example. We're looking at cleaners and lung cancer, FARC pesticides and COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And that's been carried out by the Institute of Occupational Medicine, which is in Edinburgh. And it's the budget for that is just over 50,000. And that's a sort of 18-month gradual project. We're just about to accept a proposal for a six-month timescale, probably about a month's work, for a scoping review on women and occupational health. Women have been not had the opportunity of applying for IIDB because of the traditional heavy industry background of the industrial injuries disablement benefit. And it's one of our recent campaigns now. The other thing I wanted to say was that from a regular annual budget for research that is actually getting people to help with the work instead of it being done all, including writing reports, we got a regular 25,000 a couple of years ago, and I don't think it's wrong of me to tell you that they've now managed to up this to 100,000 a year, which is about roughly, I think, if you talked to the secretariats that probably the UKSHA or the Food Standards Agency, for the committees that they are secretariats for, like the Committee on Toxicity and Carcinogenicity, is about what for one of those committees we would have. So considerably more, although I have to say, I don't think the DWP actually call it strictly a research budget.
Okay.
But it is. That's what it's for.
Thank you. Yes, that's very helpful. In what other ways does IAC get information it needs to advise ministers? But I mean, obviously, the ministers are doing a lot of work themselves. But what other ways does IAC get that information?
Commission. We do our own research. Our scientific secretary, he does research of the literature, gives us lists of the papers and so on for us. So he helps with that and the editing. But the other thing we do is we often take advice from people not on the committee, so experts where we need them. So to give you an example, one of our command papers was on cutaneous melanoma, malignant melanoma, in pilots and aircrew. And it's a command paper recommending IIDB for them, that it should go, you know, into that. And we had a lot of help from the CAA, the Civil Aviation Authorities, BALPA, the British Airline Pilots. We had a lot of help on both cosmic and UV radiation from radiation experts at what was Public Health England, that is now UKSHA. And we also had toxicological help from the Committee on Toxicity, from one of their members, on the actual mechanisms by which the excess risk occurs. So we use experts where we can if we haven't got them.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much indeed.
OK, thanks, Rina. I'm now going to invite Bob Doddison. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I was interested, Dr. Rushton, when you spoke about you'd commissioned a review, £50,000, I think, was the cost that you'd mentioned for that. So in terms of research and reviews, are you able to co-commission that? I suppose what I'm thinking about, Mr. Griffin's talking about a new body set up for Scotland, and there's a very modest research budget for that, but also there's SCOS, who, as we've heard, isn't necessarily proactive because of other commitments they've got. Is IIAC able to co-commission research jointly, be that with SCOS or with another Scottish body, even though you're not making recommendations at a Scottish level but at a UK level? Is that something you're able to do?
I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that. But it's a very interesting question. The commissioning is actually done by the DWP. So I imagine that that would need discussion. From the scientific point of view, there's absolutely no reason why there shouldn't be joint commission. And in fact, it makes economic sense, really, if one or more bodies is also interested in this, it's worth working together. But I'm afraid from the actual monetary point of view and the way one would draw up contracts and so on, I'm afraid I can't answer that.
But I think that's very helpful. Can I ask, I know we're focusing a lot on eligibility specifically for industrial injuries benefit. You may have said some of this other stuff already, but can you say a little bit more about the work of IIAC on wider issues around workplace health and safety that you may be involved in, separate from making recommendations or preventing evidence to the UK government about whether we should extend the eligibility for industrial injuries benefits? Could you maybe say a wee bit more about that?
Yes, I think that's a very pertinent question. We do, as I said, have an observer every meeting from the Health and Safety Executive. So they make sure that the Health and Safety Executive, they actually help us quite a bit. And for example, we always have a very small prevention section at the end of our command papers, and we always check with them what their advice is. And sometimes they have relevant data and they're able to help us with that. And so there's a bit of to and fro between us and the HSE. On the wider community, a lot of our members are nationally and internationally known experts in their own fields and more generally. And we have actually been discussing ourselves about the fact that actually IIDB and IAC's role is very much not known by the people that really need it, from the point of view of workers and employees and employers. So we asked thinking this year about how we individually might write in journals and so on and present. The other thing I should mention is we always have a public meeting every year or every 2 years. We have a public meeting. In fact, we had one this year in Cardiff. And since COVID, we've gone hybrid now. So we had our first hybrid meeting in the summer where people, actually it was quite good. We had quite a few people had come from across Wales as well as elsewhere to attend. So we do our best to spread both our work, but also draw attention to particular issues. For example, one of the reasons we've been looking at the pneumoconiosis is silicosis, which is often underdiagnosed. And we hope that industries such as the construction will be more aware of the issue if from some of the work we do.
Thank you, Dr. Rushton. I think you must be reading the questions that I'm about to ask you, because you're preempting them rather superbly. But it's very, very helpful, because I was going to ask you about any ongoing work programmes, and I was going to ask you about the Health and Safety Executive, referring back to Mr Mason's point about whether there's duplication, overlap or complementary work or a combination of all three. I'm conscious that the Health and Safety Executive, I think earlier this year, produced some work of research on COVID, but not long COVID. It also looked at cancer in the construction industry, not firefighters, which is something that's very topical at the moment. So there's a lot of ongoing work the Health and Safety Executive are already doing in this area, and I think you've put on record quite helpfully that you observe some of that and you've got a partnership work with them, so that's important. But do you want to say any more about your ongoing work or partnership work? And I was particularly interested in long COVID. I was interested in neurodegenerative disease in footballers and cancers in firefighters, but don't restrict yourself to that list simply because that's what I'm asking you about. I'm trying to get that dynamic between what you research, what you commission, what the Health and Safety Executive does, and how that all fits together.
You're right. There is duplication, not duplicate. Some of it duplicates and others it complements. And it's not just nationally, it's internationally as well. So one of the things we do is to keep an eye on what the Health and Safety Executive are doing, what other people are doing in the UK, what internationally is being done as well, because a lot of the information that they're collating is also very useful. Just to mention COVID has taken up, I would say, a lot of our time. We only missed one meeting, and we started monitoring the data from April 2020. We've produced two reports, one of which is a command paper. So that has been laid before Parliament, and work is being done within the DWP. We are continuing to look at that. We're particularly interested in adding, our command paper focused on health and social care workers. We're now thinking about whether we can add education and some transports, the van drivers, but the bus and coach drivers and so on. Long COVID is a really difficult issue because at the moment there's no clear diagnosis. And IIDB really needs a way of diagnose. Self-report isn't an easy thing for IIDB. We're looking at that. As I've said, we've got the commission review. We are looking at neurodegenerative diseases in footballers. I have to say that I didn't really mention earlier, we get a lot of letters and people pushing their own papers or their own, which is fair enough. I mean, they draw attention to issues. Neurodegenerative disease, we are widening it from footballers because we feel it's important to include other sports and more generally athletics, for example. And we've been looking at the actual diseases and have decided the best way forward would be to look at the diseases, some of the serious diseases one by one. And we've started with ALS, motor neurone disease, and a review of the literature is underway. But just to tell you the sort of magnitude of the literature, there are about 50 papers which are relevant that have been identified. And that is one where there does seem to be some evidence that, for example, extreme physical exercise may cause increase the risk of developing motor neurone disease. Do you want me to mention firefighters? They're a tricky one.
Dr. Rushton, I'm keen to say yes, but I know that time is probably against us. So if you could even follow up in writing with that, would really appreciate it. And to any FBU colleagues watching, it's only a time constraint. We're really keen to hear what you have to say about that. But if you could provide us that in writing, that would, the convener will have my guts for garters if we don't move on, I suspect.
Correct. Yeah, thanks very much. I've got a few questions myself that I'd like to pose to the both of you, and it's in relation to membership and expertise, and which I've touched upon already. But so what kind of knowledge and expertise are necessary to advise on social security for industrial disease and injury? And if I can bring in Dr. Simpson, first of all, thanks.
Thanks, convener. Well, I think, first of all, members probably won't be surprised to hear me say that your expertise on social security and expertise on industrial injuries are two quite distinct things. So there are a number of areas which are relevant to any social security payment, and that would include unemployment injuries payments. So, in particular, SCOS's remit includes scrutiny of regulations that are relevant to conditions of entitlement and level of benefits. And that sort of, it's hard to package that up neatly and separate it from other aspects of the benefits. So we do end up offering comment on things like application processes, supporting evidence, durations of awards, the sort of things that would be common to a range of different social security benefits. And then there are, distinct areas, some of which I think you've just been hearing about, which are particularly relevant to social security for industrial disease and injuries specifically, and these are the kind of the medical and scientific considerations, the engagement with both employer and employee perspectives. And, the kind of expertise to bring those together that you will need for good advice on social security for industrial disease and injury is going to depend on what aspects of social security and what aspects of industrial disease are going to be advised on. So based on our experiences of the devolved system to date, as functions are transferred from the DWP to Social Security Scotland, I would imagine it's likely that we'd see a devolved employment injuries benefit introduced on the basis of a safe and secure transition with relatively probably minimal changes to the diseases and injuries that confer entitlement. But in the future, we could see new diseases and injuries added, or at least considered for addition. And certainly when you get to that stage, scrutiny of the appropriateness of those sort of decisions, or the proactive provision of advice on which conditions ought to be included, those would certainly require a different kind of expertise than the SCOS board, as it stands, is set up to provide. Although we look at disability benefits, for example, the various forms of disability assistance they're concerned with the impact of an impairment on someone's daily living, on their mobility, on their care needs, and scrutinising those kind of things doesn't necessarily require specific expertise on specific conditions, but employment injuries presumably would require that kind of expertise.
Okay, thanks very much, Dr. Simpson. And Dr. Rushton, how does IAC's membership and expertise differ from that of the Social Security Advisory Committee? Can you comment on that?
I'd imagine it's quite different because we it's rather a specialist field, occupational health and medicine. So we have people who like myself, who are statisticians and epidemiologists, who've probably got wider experience than just occupation, like might be environment and within lifestyle examples, for example. But we've got at the moment three really good respiratory physicians practicing occupational respiratory, one of whom runs long COVID clinics, actually. We've got musculoskeletal experts. We have, I think, one of the most important things for any committee like that is to have an expert in the exposure side of things. We don't have a toxicologist at the moment, although I was on IAC before, till about 2004, and we did then. But I'm encouraging collaboration with our other sister committees, really. I think we don't need expertise on everything. And we've got a couple of people who are experts on mental health in occupation, including one from King's. Well, I also should have mentioned, we also have an observer who is from the military scheme. And that's very useful as well to see the parallels. So it's a mixture of science, and I think very different from the social security, the current social security. Apart from the medical side of things, some are medical qualified and some aren't. Like myself, I'm medically qualified.
Okay, thanks. That's really interesting. I'm now going to invite Katie Clarkin. Thank you.
Thank you. And my question again is for Dr. Rushton, and it's been incredibly useful to hear about your organisation's work and the skill set of those involved. Could you maybe give an indication of the time commitment that's required for your board members and the secretariat? Because it sounds as if you are involved in quite a great deal of hands-on work. Is that fair?
Absolutely. It's all done by the members at the moment. Well, apart from the commissioned review. But because we've now got some hopefully substantial funding, I'm hoping that we'll be able to, you know, release some of the work that's done by those. So it's a lot. Officially, it's four council meetings where everybody comes together. In between four meetings of the research working group, and that's a subgroup of about six or seven of the scientists. In between, there are a lot of online getting together of the subgroups who are working on particular issues. But I would say outside that, there's an enormous amount of work, and it does put people off. When we have the recruitment, it's one of the first questions that's asked. Getting something into legislation is also very time consuming. It's not done by the committee itself, although we do help if asked. We do scrutinise the legislation if it ever comes into being. But I mean, it's not directly answering this question, but I was hoping to be able to comment that once we've made a recommendation in a command paper, it's the rest of the DWP and all their colleagues and the ministers who get it through. It can take a long time. I just wanted to say that to you, and I don't know what you have planned. It's nothing to do with me, but just to bear in mind that once you've got the advice, it can potentially take a long time to turn into legislation. And that's a little one of the other things that's quite difficult for members.
Yes, I'm sure it can be very frustrating in terms of how the system works. I mean, in these situations, there's obviously often different perspectives. I was previously a personal injury lawyer, and so very aware that the employer can have a very different perspective than the employee and their representatives. So how do you deal with that, the fact that you have these different perspectives from employers and employees, and how is that represented in your work?
That's a good question. And we do keep an eye on what the court case. We have a legal person with legal expertise as well on the council. We keep an eye on what court cases do, and they keep an eye on IAC. I should have mentioned right from the start that it depends on the we answer to the legislation, and the legislation says we have to be reasonably certain that the connection between work and the disease is true, and that there is this link, because it is a no-fault compensation system. And compared with a lot of other international systems, that's an advantage, very much so, for the claimant. So that's something to bear in mind as for the current system. Often the decisions we make are hidebound by this reasonable certainty. The firefighters example is a very good one. Where we have a good human data, and when increasingly we haven't got the studies, we look for a high relative risk, a double the risk. That's the easy one. But often we don't have it, or it doesn't quite reach it. And up to now, the committee have been very very strict in what they do. We're starting to think about ways of getting around the problem when we don't have the data. But sometimes we're faced with good data, and really, although there's a link, it's not sufficient under the legislation. And that is quite hard for people like unions and employers to take on board. And it's quite hard for us too, but we are set up to do one job, which is to advise on that legislation.
And I'll ask this question to both witnesses, but I'll, if we ask Dr. Rushton first, how do the bodies consider the views of those with relevant lived experience? Is that something that is part of your consideration? So do you take, how do you capture that, if you like, in the work that you do, would you say?
Well, we certainly, we get a lot of letters from individuals, and we certainly respond to them. They're very useful. They draw attention to particular issues, which is important, or particular aspects of a situation which we may not have considered. What we don't do is deal with individuals in terms of claims. We're an advisory council. We always write back to people, but and certainly with some of the issues, people will want to come and talk to us, and they do come and talk to us. But when it comes to helping them, we as a council can't do that. We can take on board what they say, but we can't directly impact on them. Does that help?
Yes, I think you have answered that question. Thank you very much. And if I could put the same question to Dr. Simpson, how you take into account the views of and what is said by those with relevant lived experience?
No problem. So when we're carrying out our scrutiny work at SCOS, which has been the vast majority of our work up to this point, we do try to take account of the views and the expertise of a range of stakeholders and people with experience of the area of social security that we're looking at the time. Is a group that we're always sort of trying to up our game on how we include them. I give a short example from one of our recent pieces of scrutiny work, which was the carers support payment regulations. So as part of that, we held a round table with carers, which we worked alongside a carers organisation to convene that. We also spoke to a range of stakeholder organisations working with carers, and as part of that, we asked them to sort of, speak on behalf of themselves to give a corporate view, but also to try to give us a flavour of what their clients, their users, and their members had to say about the subject. So there were a total of 12 different organisations that we contacted as part of that process. Our secretariat did some desk-based research for us to try and find what information was already published on carers' experiences of social security. And finally, we had a roundtable discussion with a number of academic researchers, and some of their work, although not necessarily all of those researchers, but certainly some of them would have been involved in work with people with lived experience of caregiving, of care benefits, or both. What information we draw from those encounters, you know, it certainly doesn't determine what goes into our report or what recommendations we make, but we certainly draw on those insights to inform both the content of the reports, to provide examples to illustrate some of the points that we're making. And, you know, sometimes we do draw recommendations fairly directly from that process. At other times, we'll gain insights that we kind of think, well, that's maybe not so relevant to this current report, but maybe there's an issue there that we can come back to in the future, maybe when we're thinking about what aspects of the charter we want to look at. So that engagement can be fruitful in all sorts of ways.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Dr. Simpson, Dr. Rushton. I'm supporter of the points that Mark Griffin is raising, but does it not put the kind of cart before the horse, as obviously the Scottish Government has not yet consulted on their plans for a new employment injury assistance scheme? Is there not a kind of reasonable argument that the principles and rationale should be considered when a full-scale in terms of the Scottish Government's intentions to set out part of the wider consultation? I just want to pop that out for your views, if that's okay.
Just remind members as well that this is purely in terms of their views. It's more in line with context setting here. So just to bear that in mind.
I'm asking about the timing of the bill, so I think it's relevant.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know if I can give you a particularly clear answer on that. I'm not clear at the minute what the likely timeline is going to be for employment injuries assistance. I do know that, you know, setup takes a little bit of time. For example, I can talk a little bit about the establishment of SCOS. So the Social Security Act was passed in mid-2018. I think work on recruiting on setting up the SCOS commenced pretty quickly after that. We held our first board meeting in February 2019, and we published our first pre-legislative scrutiny report in May 2019, which was on the Young Carer Grant regulations. So yeah, we were able to go from a standing start to producing a report fairly quickly. But we were also trying to juggle some of the business of setting up a new body alongside that, which brought its own challenges. There had also been some legislative activity in social security before we were established. I'm not going to give you, I'm afraid, a straight answer on when would be the right time to set up this kind of body, but other than to say that getting set up can be a challenge in itself in some ways.
Thank you. Dr. Rushton, do you want to express a view?
In terms of IAC?
In terms of, the actual the bill that's proposed by Mark Griffin. Do you not wait till the government sets out their intentions?
Yes. IAC is independent, an independent advisory committee. So we would continue our work, I think. If a Scottish body was set up, I think we would want to certainly make sure that we didn't duplicate. I can see that there might be duplication. I think it would depend very much on how you set your legislation up, because at the moment we're working to the Social Security Act and the reasonably certain issue. And that makes us very different from in other countries. And that's why our so-called lists are different from other countries. So COVID is a good example. We, as a country, didn't put COVID as a part of the industrial injuries disablement benefit until we had the evidence. And it took a long time. And other countries have got systems. So I think we would want to work together and perhaps have representatives on both. You might end up with the same scientists on each of the committees, actually, because it's a very small group of people in the UK. I don't know whether that helps.
No, that's fine. Obviously, you've raised concerns already about, you know, the timing of legislation and getting it passed. You know, back on the issue of timescale, industrial injuries disablement benefit has been largely unreformed since its creation many years ago. And you've obviously mentioned about, you know, the 20s into 1948 and how complex that benefit is. Do you feel it's due to the lack of research or the lack of political interest in bringing the benefit into a new world, kind of real setting, really, given you obviously kind of said as well that yourself that women have been excluded from applying? So can I get your views on that as well?
Yes, the women, I think that's largely historic, because, the benefit goes right back to the 1920s and before on minors and so on. So many of the current prescriptions, the diseases that are on there, are no longer exist, but they're not taken off. And they're certainly reacting to the very heavy industry that we used to have, and hence not applicable to the women. We're very well aware that women aren't covered. They do apply, of course, especially for the musculoskeletal side of things. But that's why we're making that a priority. As far as the legislation is concerned, I don't think myself and the committee are qualified to give direct evidence, because we haven't formally considered it. But you're absolutely right that we work to that we have to follow the legislation's meaning, and that does restrict us. And I think a comparison. There are one or two good articles comparing the different schemes across the world. There are huge differences across the world, and it depends. It's a political thing, really, as to how a country feels about industrial injuries and industrial accidents.
Thank you. Really appreciate your comments there. Dr. Simpson, do you want to kind of share anything before I hand back to the convener?
Yes, please. I just wanted to pick up on some of the points that Leslie was making about recruitment. I don't know how big a pool a future SIAC body would be fishing in terms of finding people with the expertise that it needs, but that has been an issue for SCOS at times when we've had vacancies, and it could be again for that body. And I should also add as well that the DWP does not allow dual membership of the Social Security Advisory Committee and SCOS, and it might well take the same position when it comes to PAIAC and SIAC.
Thanks for that. Thanks for your indulgence, Chair.
Okay, thanks very much. Conscious of time, so if I can just remind everyone to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible. And I'm going to now invite Jeremy in, who's joining us online. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you, Mayor, and good morning. I will be fairly brief because I think a lot of my questions have been dealt with. Question to you, if that's okay, Dr. Simpson. In the absence of this bill, what additional resources or expertise would SCOS need to consider regulations creating EIA? So we know it's coming, probably 2025, that will require regulations. What would you need to be able to scrutinise that properly?
Okay, thank you. I think the starting point for this is that, in a sense, scrutinising the draft set of Employment Injuries Assistance Regulations would be in line with, you know, with the remit that the SCOS currently has, and you know the expertise of the current membership kind of reflects the role that the Commission was set up to undertake. If that role were to be widened or to incorporate additional areas of responsibility in the future, then you know the membership would have to be widened accordingly, or we'd need to make more use of subcommittees than we have up to now to make sure we could do what was required. I mean, I mentioned earlier that you know we can probably assume that the priority is as it normally has been with the introduction of a new devolved benefit will be on safe and secure transfer. In that context, it might not be a huge challenge, but in the future, if changes were being made to that sort of set of conditions that confer entitlement, then that might be more of an issue. But in general terms, the expertise that's needed to fulfil our responsibilities can change over time. In any case, depending on what we're scrutinising, our membership changes too. So I've mentioned the stakeholder engagement work that we do. You know, we have the ability to set up committees and subcommittees to bring in additional expertise if we needed it. So I guess we would make use of some of those opportunities if we needed to.
I mean, that's helpful, Dr. Simpson. I mean, I know, having read all your reports since set up, that one of the issues has been the timing in regard to how much time you've had to scrutinise regulations and the resources. It's difficult to put a figure on it, but do you think how much more resources would you require in regard to take on yet another piece of work?
That's really hard for me to say. I'm probably not sufficiently on top of our of that side of our operation to give you a useful answer, and it would also depend very much on you know what was being asked of us. You know, if we were scrutinising a set of draft regulations, you know, we'd follow our normal practice, but we might need a bit of time or money to, you know, to appoint people to subcommittees or to commission external research if it was a very complex set, and that could be difficult within the context of the, you know, the legislative timetable. It can be fairly demanding, as you know. You know, speaking hypothetically, you know, at the minute, the more proactive functions that are envisaged for the SIAC in this bill aren't functions that we currently have. But you know, I can imagine, you know, with some of the figures that Leslie has been talking about earlier, they're certainly significantly higher than the amount of money that we have budgeted for external research in the current year. So you know, you can probably draw your own conclusions on that if we were, you know, if we were being asked to give more forward-looking advice on conditions to include.
Thank you again. If I can just move on very briefly to you, Dr. Ruston. Whether this bill passes or not, you will continue to publish your reports containing advice to UK ministers. To what extent do you consider a wider audience when publishing your reports? Is it maybe not for the average person on the street, but how wide do these reports go, and do you monitor who reads them?
That's a really interesting question. The reports, everything is on the website. And in fact, our minutes are used a lot by people because they can see exactly where we're going with our thoughts because they're quite full. The reports are also, all of them, and they're all, as I mentioned, the position papers and the command papers are in the House of Lords and House of Commons libraries. At the moment, we do not write lay people's papers, and we don't do regular updates in the sort of general scientific press. However, we are very well aware about this, and we are actually at the next meeting having a discussion about how we might improve this, both in the scientific community and apart from the public meeting, how do we get it out to the employee community. So we're thinking about seeing if we can't find an employee journal and a scientific journal where we get regular, if you like, little slots where we just do an update, because we are very well aware that a lot of people don't know about these things. The difficulty with all worker groups is getting to the small and the medium-sized groups who won't, probably not, don't even look at the HSC website. But we are starting to do something about that. And you've picked out a point where we haven't had the time, to be honest, with all the work we've been doing, to think about what we do about that. But we do publish everything that we produce.
Thank you. I'll leave it there, convener. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite in Paul Keane, and that ends our question session. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Perhaps just following on from where Jeremy Balfour left off, the DACBEG, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that acronym correctly, but the advisory group, the expert group on disability and carers' benefits, they essentially have advised ministers on EIA already. I'm just keen to perhaps understand the view, Dr. Simpson's view, if another non-statutory group was created, would it be able to provide the required advice on any kind of detailed policy development for EIA? Or, would that have to sit somewhere else?
That's a wee bit of a challenging question. I mean, policy advice could come in many forms and does come in many forms, whether solicited or unsolicited. And I expect that would continue. The notes accompanying the bill sort of set out a number of possible avenues for obtaining this sort of guidance. If Mark Griffin's preferred option of setting up the SIAC was not adopted, and undoubtedly there's more than one model that could be that could be made to work. If the right expertise is there, then the advice is going to be useful. There was the policy memorandum that itself notes, if you have something that's set up on a statutory footing with a formal requirement to be consulted, then it's harder for that expertise that's there to be ignored. But, you know, I don't really want to go beyond that, because, you know, I'm not here to offer a position on what's the correct model, but, you know, various options are available.
Thanks, and I appreciate today's for context, convener, so I think I'll leave it there.
Okay. Thanks very much, and thank you to our witnesses, Dr. Rushton and Dr. Simpson, for taking part and sharing your very valuable expertise on this. We will continue taking evidence on the bill in the coming weeks, and that concludes our public business. So thank you once again for joining us. Agenda.